Dann darf ich Sie herzlich willkommen heißen zur Antrittsvorlesung unseres Kollegen Professor Dr. George Warkton. Und ihr habt die schöne Aufgabe, ein bisschen über sein Leben zu erzählen, bevor er hier bei uns angekommen ist. George Warkton hat sein Studium an der Universität Cambridge absolviert, also einer der ältesten und höchst gerankten Universitäten der Welt. Und er wurde dort akzeptiert, nicht weil er adlig war oder der Sohn von Millionären, sondern aus diesem anderen Grund, Er hat dort eine BA-Thesis zur History of German Negation before 1350 verfasst. Und ich erwähne das, weil das mein Lieblingsthema ist. Ich werde jetzt etwas grobkörniger fortschreiten. Und im Jahr 2012 war seine Dissertation Syntactic Reconstruction and Proto-Germanic fertiggestellt und wurde eingereicht. Im Jahr 2014 ist sie bei Oxford University Press erschienen. Ich weise darauf hin, es ist die Konkurrenzeinrichtung. Das scheint mir ein Zeichen für die Qualität der Arbeit zu sein. Die Arbeit verfolgt die These, dass wir wie im Lautwandel, wo wir ja ältere Stufen von Wörtern begründet rekonstruieren können und wissen, was davor war und sein kann, so argumentiert er in der Arbeit, können wir auch die syntaktischen Stadien vorher und dazwischen rekonstruieren. Und zwar auf eine Weise, die nicht nur so Lehnstuhlphilologie ist, dass man so sagt, ja, ja, so könnte es gewesen sein, sondern wir wissen jetzt genug über die universellen Strukturen der Syntax, dass wir solche Rekonstruktionen dann wissenschaftlich begründet vornehmen können und damit erstmals wissenschaftlich valide Informationen über Sprachstadien haben, die zwischen denen liegen, wo überlieferte Quellen zugänglich sind. Die Dissertation verbindet drei Dimensionen und jede einzelne davon ist gewichtig genug, um eine wissenschaftliche Karriere darauf zu gründen, denke ich. Also sie beinhaltet Korpuslinguistik auf professionellem Niveau. Beiläufig wurde das erste Altsächsisch-Korpus, ein geparstes Helian-Korpus, erstellt nach den Standards der UPenn Standards for Historical Corpora. Es wird generative Syntax der anspruchsvollen Art betrieben, nämlich die, wie sie nicht bei Chomsky steht. Die Herausforderungen sind ähnlich wie andere moderne germanische Sprachen und das ist wirklich schwierig. Und schließlich ist er auch nicht ein historischer Sprachwissenschaftler von dieser Zaungastsorte, dass man sagt, ihr habt mal drei übersetzte Sätze und damit hangel ich mich durch meine Thesen. Nein. Wir finden einen sicheren Überblick über die historischen Quellen, eine sichere Kontextualisierung, eine detaillierte historische Einordnung der Daten auf einem wissenschaftlich höchsten Niveau. Die Publikationen seit 2011 bezeugen, dass du alle drei Dimensionen auf höchstem Niveau beherrschst und zur Forschung dort beiträgst. Diese Verzeichnisse sind dynamisch, ich habe gezählt jetzt, in 2015 beim ersten Kontakt mit unserer Universität lagen 13 Aufsätze vor in Zeitschriften wie dem Journal of Germanic Linguistics, Nordic Journal of Linguistics, English Language and Linguistics, Language Variation, Diaconica, Lingua, mehrere Handbücher und andere Sammelbände sowie noch etwas in Begutachtung. Als ich die Laudatio im Jahr 2016 verfassen durfte, war schon angeschwollen auf 15 Aufsätze plus N in der Pipeline. Ein aktueller Besuch auf der Homepage hat mich, also da bei 20 habe ich dann aufgehört zu zählen und habe nur konstatiert, das Werk schwillt an. Aber du bist nicht nur im stillen Kämmerlein tätig, sondern tatkräftig auch an allen Fronten der Linguistik. Du bist Main Associate Editor bei Language, zuständig für Historical Linguistics. Bei näherem Studieren der Unterlagen habe ich begriffen, du hast diese Sektion begründet und bist damit ein lebendiges Mitglied der Open Access Initiative von Language in den USA. Du hattest, und vielleicht hast du noch, die undankbare Aufsatz des Treasurer bei einer wissenschaftlichen Gesellschaft. Das kann doch nicht sein. Du bist Webmaster der Linguistic Society of Great Britain. Bist du das immer noch? Okay, ja, ich habe schon gedacht, wir hätten hier alternative Aufgaben. Du bist international sichtbar als Blogger, als Interviewer und Interviewee und weitere vielfältige Transferaktivitäten. Was haben wir damit gewonnen, dass George jetzt bei uns in Konstanz ist? Er ergänzt das Spektrum unserer Sprachen um die klassischen Sprachen Gotisch, Altsächsisch, um Mandarin, Chinesisch und, ich freue mich auch zu sagen, um Deutsch. Das ist wichtig als Forschungsgegenstand. Er hat sich zwangsläufig, aber unverdrossen damit auseinandergesetzt, dass die Anglistik im Moment gänzlich auf seinen Schultern ruht, organisiert Vertretungen, renoviert schonend die Prüfungspraktiken, koordiniert die Studentenschaft auch durch beherzte populäre Maßnahmen. Zum Beispiel im Sommer 2017 trat er als DJ bei der Fachschaftsparty To Be or Not To Be auf der Fachschaften Linguistik und Mathematik, ist es, glaube ich. Ne? Nach deinem Kommentar war es ein Vintage-Event für die jungen Leute. Und ich glaube, er hat bei den Studierenden deinen Status als Guru gefestigt. Er ist weiterhin wissenschaftlich international sichtbar, zum Beispiel im Frühjahr dieses Jahres als Plenary Speaker bei der Jahrestagung Diachronic Generative Syntax DIGS in York. Eine Tagung, die gibt es seit 1990, das heißt seit 28 Jahren. Älter als Sinn und Bedeutung, das ist meine Haustagung. Mehr Veranstaltungen als SALT und das Amsterdam Kolloquium, also keine Eintagsfliege, sondern ein gewichtiges und klassisches Forum historischer Forschung. Wir profitieren laufend von deiner Außensicht aufs deutsche universitäre Wesen und auch von deiner Innensicht auf das angelsächsische System, das bei uns ja unter BAMA kopiert wird, oder wir versuchen das. Und es ist manchmal gut, wenn jemand korrigiert und sagt, das war nicht so gemeint, vielleicht machen wir es anders. Aber, lieber George, und das Wichtigste zuletzt, George hat die Infrastruktur des Fachbereichs innovativ weiterentwickelt. Und zwar durch das Verlegen von Eisenbahngeleisen, umgerechnet im Äquivalent einer Länge von 20 Kilometern, etwa im Maßstab H0 in deinem Büro. Ich freue mich jetzt auf deine Antrittsvorlesung, die die Frage untersucht, English, the black sheep of the Germanic family. Ich wollte jetzt elegant weiterleiten, aber jetzt haben wir noch einen kurzen Umbau hier.
Well, thank you very much for this very generous and thoroughly embarrassing introduction. Just as in a good long tradition of such things, I think. I sufficiently red-faced, I now begin my exposition. I'm really pleased to see so many of you here. I'm just really happy that so many people have come to see me talk about things that are interesting mainly to me. And as a result, I hope that I'm also going to make what I have to say today interesting to you guys. I'm going to keep it at a relatively, hopefully relatively low level so that everyone should be able to get something out of it. If you want to follow things up with me about the detail or any of the technical points that come up or that are implied by what I say, do feel free to chip in the question period or maybe better approach me over drinks afterwards. I'm a little bit sick, so if I sniff a little bit too much and it comes into the microphone, I apologize. With that, I think I shall begin. So here's an overview of what I do, and today is going to be a kind of smorgasbord of bits and pieces from my research. The overarching theme is the weirdness of English as a language, which may be something that doesn't necessarily... It's not immediately obvious, perhaps simply because English is so salient. It is the world language today, under most ways in which you might define that term. And so it's easy to overlook just how unusual it is, especially in the context of the languages that it grew up alongside. This is the general topic. I'll show you, and this fits in with my general stance on English linguistics and my stance on general linguistics, because my position is both, and I am fully of the conviction that you can't do one without the other. So for a start, I'm interested in questions such as what happened in the prehistory, the Germanic prehistory of English. Where most people's history of English ends is actually where mine kind of begins. Some of the stuff that I'm the most interested in is the stuff that happens before the attested history of the English language. I'm also interested in why and how English differs from the other Germanic languages, and this, I think, is a kind of, among English linguists in general, it's certainly a selling point for me that I do this comparative work. That is very much my perspective. I look at English in that Germanic context. In all of these domains, I'm mostly interested in syntax, which I'll come back to on the next slide. And I'm also very, very interested, increasingly interested, in modeling the effects of language contact. So when two languages come into contact with each other. I've always found this notion of language contact actually to be a rather weird one, because it kind of suggests that you've got these amorphous sort of balloons that are floating around in the ether. One of them is French and one of them is English, and they kind of bounce off one another, and maybe part of the French balloon will rub off on the English balloon, or maybe one of them will burst. But we know that that's not the right way to think about language. And we actually want very much to think about language, at least I want very much to think about language, in terms that have become increasingly central in 20th century linguistic theory, where the focus has very much shifted from this more amorphous sort of high level, society level conception of what it means to be a language to the individual knowledge of a speaker hearer. Within a community, because those are the people who are really coming into contact. When we talk about language contact, that's always the situation. We're talking about people coming into contact with other people, and they happen to speak languages that may be different. So I'm interested in these general questions of how and why language changes, and for that, I have a methodological strand to my research, which Regina has already mentioned. I am a great advocate of past historical corpora, which the term corpora refers to collections of texts. Pars text means texts that have been annotated, which have been enriched with a particular kind of linguistic information, and that is syntactic information, information about the syntactic structure of what we find in the texts. And I have used these corpora extensively. I've done some work developing them myself. This is the sort of the main tool of the trade for what I do, essentially. And so this all goes to bring together historical linguistics in the traditional sense, which has a very, very strong pedigree, particularly in the 19th and early 20th century. Like I say, 20th century grammatical theory, which focuses more on the individual. And there is more tension between these two conceptions than it might appear at first sight. And that I find extremely interesting and actually extremely valuable for generating new insights about language change by taking people into account, in essence. So when I talk about syntax, for those of you who aren't familiar with this, I'm just talking about the study of sentence structure, in essence, including order and relations between words. This is a very neutral way of defining what I mean by syntax. Specifically, what I do is syntax in the tradition of generative grammar, so in the tradition of various works initiated by Noam Chomsky and the people around him in the 50s and 60s. And this line of research, in the broad sense, has two, I think, two major distinguishing features from what came before. Firstly, the object of study is very much syntax in the mind of the individual speaker hearer. And secondly, when we talk about syntax, we don't have to use natural language as our descriptive meta-language to talk about natural language. Rather, we can avail ourselves of tools that have been developed in the context of originally in the context of formal logic and refined for their specifically syntactic use. So here I notice a couple of you in the room who are in my Syntax 1 class. I've been torturing these guys with phrase structure rules this afternoon. And this is a kind of example of, at the high level, what the formalism looks like. If we say that a sentence can be rewritten, this S is a sentence rewritten as NP, VP, then we're saying that a sentence consists of a noun phrase and a verb phrase. We can use that to model the structure of an English sentence, say, with its subject, here, Mary, and the VP itself can then be rewritten as a V and an NP. You have a structure. And this kind of structure is not just a nice kind of formal nicety for linguists, rather it makes predictions. It makes predictions about what this entity is. It says that these two form an entity, constituent, to the exclusion of this one. That makes various testable predictions. We'll come back to the importance of this kind of reasoning in a bit. But first I should move on to talk about the family that I'm talking about. So this Germanic family, who am I talking about here? We're talking about the Germanic language family, and there are three branches of Germanic under the normal understanding. So first of all, we've got the family that will be interesting us the most, which is West Germanic. It's a little bit controversial how exactly you slice up the pie for West Germanic, but often Frisian is grouped very closely together with English as under an Anglo-Frisian node, saying that these are more closely related to each other than either of them is to say German or Dutch. Historically speaking, like I say, not all of this is uncontroversial, but this is one way of drawing the tree. When we then look at the North Germanic languages, these are basically our Scandinavian languages, and they are divided into West and East, This division is now somewhat notional because there has been constantly so much contact and convergence between these languages. At least between the bottom three, Icelandic is something of a special case and a focus of a great deal of research here in Konstanz, where we seem to have a very inexplicable obsession with a tiny island in the north of the Atlantic Ocean. But believe me, it really is interesting. I only wish I could talk about it more today, but I felt that English would be a more unifying theme. And then finally down here, we've got Swedish and Danish, and not to forget, poor old East Germanic. East Germanic, the only majorly, seriously attested member of this language is Gothic, and as you can see, the Gothic sheep has seen very much better days. There are no speakers of Gothic left, at least not native speakers. There we have the family that I'm talking about. And one of the questions that I've addressed, and again, Regina alluded to this in her introduction, is the structure of the mother language. So what happens when we try and reconstruct backwards? We have texts from Gothic, we have texts from Old High German, we have texts from Old English, we have texts from Old Norse. Can we extrapolate backwards using the knowledge that we have of processes of language change and of the texts themselves and the structure that underlies them? And obviously my view is that you can, because I wrote a whole book about it. And this book you can see here, it's available now in paperback from $24.99 from most good bookshops. And if you're not convinced by that, you can go and watch this little trailer, which gives you a cinematic introduction to the Syntactic Reconstruction and Proto-Germanic book. My one regret about all of this is that through being featured on LanguageLog, this trailer has probably been viewed more times than the entire of the rest of my linguistic oeuvre put together. So it's a real mixed blessing doing something like this. And I'm not going to focus on these early historical questions now, because my focus in recent years has come forward in time towards texts that actually exist. And so what I'm going to tell you about today is I'm going to give you two case studies of the kind of research that I've been doing. So first of all, I'm going to outline what I mean when I say that English is weird, English is a black sheep. I'm going to give you two case studies. The first one is to do with verb second and its loss in the history of English. The third one is to do with negation and the changes in negation that take place in the history of English. And then I'll conclude with some wild and somewhat ridiculous speculation at the end. What do I mean when I say that English is weird? Well, this is probably best understood by looking at some examples. Here I've taken examples. What would you call this lady? She is some kind of doctor and she works with teeth. So you might choose to do what most of the Germanic languages do, in fact, all of them apart from English, and use a word for tooth and a word for doctor. That seems like a fairly reasonable approach, except that English is having none of it. And English chooses this other word, dentist, which doesn't even meaningfully relate to any other words in the language. So we've got this special word for this special type of doctor. English seemingly wanting to be special in this regard. Take another example. All right, there is a lovely slab of meat. And in fact, when you look at this, you can, if you're a meat expert, identify that it is a specific type of meat. Specifically, it is Rindfleisch. It is beef. And thereby hangs a tale, because again, you might just think that the best way of referring to a type of meat that comes from a certain kind of animal is to use a word for the animal and a word for meat. And that indeed is what all of the Germanic languages do apart from English. In English, we have this word beef. It's quite easy to pick and choose examples from vocabulary because vocabulary changes and shifts around. It's a little bit more flexible and floppier. And for that reason, that's one of the reasons I like to focus on syntax. So let's take a syntactic example now. So here we've got a word order example. If you take a sentence like this one, in all of these Germanic languages, you would, if you have your word for tomorrow in first position, you would also then have your verb in second position, followed by the subject. And as you can by this point predict what I'm going to say, even if it wasn't on the slide, you would be able to, English doesn't conform to this pattern. So what's going on here? We have the subject first and then the verb. So this verb second rule, which in the Germanic context is all over the place, seems to be somehow mysteriously absent or restricted in the present day English language. What is with that? Another word order example. Now this is a different kind of example because what this one shows you is you should never take things at face value in language. There's a lot of interesting stuff going on under the surface that you might want to ask about. So here we've got, I'm showing you a construction that is called VP fronting, because in terms of the theory of syntax we talked about earlier, it involves a particular constituent, the verb phrase, and its contents, and that comes at the front, hence fronting. So here we've got Kuchen gegessen hat er, and some a Dutch equivalent, a Swedish equivalent. In English, we can do this too, right? The word order is like Swedish and not like German and Dutch. That's for independent reasons. That doesn't make English particularly unusual. What makes English unusual is coming later, because there's nothing on the surface unusual about this. This just looks like something that languages can do on the whole. It's stylistically pretty restricted, to be sure. That's why there's a picture of Yoda up here, because he's very keen on this kind of sentence, and he likes to front verb phrases all over the place, including in contexts where most speakers would find it very, very infelicitous, or it's a borderline unacceptable. But, you know, he's 800 years old, and he's an alien from a long time ago in a place far, far away, so I think we can excuse him a little bit of weirdness, right. Just like we should excuse the English language. What's going on here? Why do I say that this is weird? Well, because if we look at it, the traditional way of viewing this kind of sentence, certainly within the generative approach, has been to say, well, look, it looks like it's a verb phrase that comes before the other stuff. So how do we analyze that? Well, we can say, the verb phrase starts out at the bottom, at the end of the sentence, and it's moved. There is a transformation that moves it to initial position. So I could show you again. There you go. The verb phrase, eaten cake, is just moving to the front of the sentence. And similarly, in the German case, you can say that exactly the same thing has happened. You have a sentence which is underlyingly something like, hat er Kuchen gegessen, and Kuchen gegessen, eaten cake, moves to the front of the sentence. All well and good. Or is it? Well, in a forthcoming paper with Gary Toms, I've argued that this, though it looks quite an appealing little story, and it's got a very long pedigree, it's actually wrong. It actually has to be wrong because of the evidence that we see. So, one piece of evidence, and there are both judgment data on this in terms of what speakers will and won't accept as a sentence of the language, and there are corpus data on this as well in terms of what speakers will actually produce and writers will actually produce as users of the language. One construction that is perfectly grammatical in at least the varieties of English that both me and Gary speak and a lot of people we've talked to as well is to say something like, he said he would do his homework and do his homework he has. Why is this a problem? I mean, like I say, it sounds completely natural to me. The problem is when you start thinking about it as having this kind of structure, so where the verb phrase has moved out and to initial position, because the verb phrase in its base position, which is following the subject, cannot take this form. He has do his homework is appallingly awful. This is a completely ungrammatical sentence. Similarly, you can't just front any old verb phrase. There are special constraints on when you can and can't front verb phrases in English. And it, that basically the constraint is that there needs to be a certain kind of auxiliary verb in there, something like have or do or be or will. So you can't just take a... so here you've got something, hates John, which looks like a verb phrase that we saw earlier, but you can't just take it and move it to the front of the sentence and give you hates John Mary. That is completely awful. Why would that be if this is simply a movement operation that takes the verb phrase to the front of the sentence? And what's interesting in this regard is that German and Dutch do not have these properties. For German and Dutch, the movement analysis that I showed you, this thing, works just fine. Right? It doesn't have the properties. You don't get things like, correct me if I'm wrong, but Kuchen essen hat er. No, right. Shake of the head from Georg in the front row. This is bad. So English can do this, but the other languages can't. And what this means is that something that looks on the surface like a completely unobjectionable, normal feature of a Germanic language, in English is actually monstrous and weird, or at least the you can read our paper and decide for yourself whether our analysis of these facts is monstrous and weird. I'm not going to dwell on it anymore now. But the lesson here is that sometimes you can look under the hood and you can find that English is weird, even when it appears not to be on the surface. So obviously what we want to do is not just list facts all evening. What we want to do is explain what's going on. And there are various different ways of doing this. We can look at the system of English, we can look at how it fits together, we can look at how it's acquired, how it's structured, what's called in the Saussurean tradition of a synchronic approach. And sometimes that will shed light on the facts that we find, and it will do so in a very intuitively satisfying manner. And this, I think, is the case for this verb phrase fronting construction, which I've just showed you. Other times, to me at least, a more satisfying explanation is obtained by taking a diachronic approach, looking at the language in the context of its history. Where did these constructions come from? How did they arise? And that's what I'm going to be talking about for the rest of today, this diachronic approach. Now again, I should mention, words like dentist and beef, if we look at the external history of English, it's almost immediately obvious what's happened here. You can pin it down, you can say, well, there's the obvious suspect is right over there. If this was some sort of murder mystery, the jury would not take long to decide who done it. But the syntactic cases are a little bit more intricate, and that's what I'm going to talk about now. So first of all, I'm going to talk about a paper from Journal of Comparative Linguistics from 2017. Then I'm going to talk about a change in negation in English that we've discussed in a paper with one of my co-authors from also 2017. But before I do that, it's worth mentioning something else. One way of getting around the problem of the weirdness of English in the context of being a West Germanic language is to hypothesize that it's something else. So if I can mix my animal metaphors for a moment here, maybe this black sheep is really a cuckoo in the nest, right? Maybe English is not descended from West Germanic at all. Maybe at least present-day English comes from somewhere else. Maybe it's some other kind of language. And there have been a few different proposals here. So everyone pretty much agrees that Old English is a West Germanic language. But what's sometimes been argued is that somewhere down the line there is a break in transmission, that English becomes no longer a West Germanic language, becomes something else. What exactly it becomes, there have been different proposals. So one proposal is that English is what's called a Creole language. And this is a special kind of language that doesn't have any direct parents in a family tree. Depending on who you ask, English became a Creole language due to contact with Norman French, or it became a Creole due to contact with Scandinavian languages, with North Germanic. Both of these have been proposed. I think the Creole hypothesis has pretty much gone away now. It's pretty much been debunked. I don't know anyone who believes it solidly anymore. Though one has to note, in defense of these people, they are really taking seriously the observation that English is weird in a Germanic context, and they're trying to explain it. Right? And even if that explanation is wrong, which I think it is, it's an interesting approach for trying to understand these properties. Similarly, a very recent book by Emmons and Forlund argues that English is actually a North Germanic language. So English somehow became Scandinavian between the Old and Middle English period. And what's interesting about their book is that they base their argumentation on syntax, so on grammatical structures, sentence structures, rather than what is more traditional, on evidence from sound change, from phonological change. Now, in a paper with Christine Bech, I've argued in quite some detail that this doesn't work in two ways. First of all, the syntactic evidence that they use, I don't think holds water when you examine it more closely. Secondly, even if the syntactic evidence were to hold water, it still wouldn't actually make the case that they're trying to make, that English is a North Germanic language, because you can't just make a case on the basis of syntactic features. You have to look at other aspects of the language as well. So I think we have to say, somewhat reluctantly, that English is still a West Germanic language. And that indeed is the title of my paper with Christine Bech. English is still a West Germanic language. So we have to say that it's a West Germanic language, but that actually makes our job a little bit harder, because then these weirdnesses still need to be explained. So let's take a case study now. I'm going to start with the loss of verb second in the history of English, and I'm going to take a slightly different angle to most people who've discussed this. Because I'm going to talk about an earlier phase of the language than people usually talk about. So this is just a reminder, in case you've forgotten what I said about 10 minutes ago. This is all of the other Germanic languages doing a beautiful verb second thing with the subject after the verb. Here's English with the subject before the verb. Why is English like this? And English is alone among the standard Germanic languages in not being a verb second language. Moreover, and what's really interesting here is that this state of affairs is not actually new. Here's an example from Old English that gets cited all the time. So here you've got, after his Gebete, er erhob das Kind up. After his prayer, he lifted the child up. This word order, on the surface, is perfectly grammatical in modern English. Right? This looks like a beautiful modern English sentence because it has the subject and then the finite verb. There are two constituents before the verb, and therefore I'm going to call these constructions verb third constructions rather than verb second constructions. And it's not completely random when you find these in Old English. There are certain elements that can kind of sneak in and break the verb second rule. Most typically, it's these subject pronouns. It's when you've got another element that isn't a subject in first position, and then a subject pronoun comes in before the verb. That is the most common case of violations of verb second in Old English. In other contexts, you do find verb second. So it's not true to say that verb second is completely gone by this stage of the language, but this is certainly not a verb second language in the usual sense of the term, by no means. But here's what's interesting, and here's a comparison that I think I was the first to draw, partly because it's kind of an odd thing to have in your head at the same time. Old English is not the only language, not the only Germanic language that does this. I said very carefully earlier on, Old English is the only standard, English is the only standard Germanic language that doesn't have verb second. When you start looking at non-standard varieties, the picture becomes a lot more interesting. And these are actually not the only ones that I could name, but these are the ones we're going to focus on today. And these varieties have been called urban vernaculars because they are spoken in cities. And I'll say a little bit more about the demographic circumstances under which these languages arrive. The first and most arguably most interesting is this one here, Kiezdeutsch, which is the German urban vernacular. This is a variety that's been argued to be a dialect of German, a new dialect of German by Heike Wieser. And it has a lot of interesting syntactic properties. You can actually see two of them here, but the one we're going to focus on is the verb third property. You've got your adverb, you've got your pronoun, and then you've got your verb. So this is a verb third structure. Morgen ich gehe Arbeitsamt. Similarly, in the Danish equivalent of the urban of the Danish equivalent urban vernacular spoken in Copenhagen, you find usually one subject, man, goes to youth club. Here we've got with LimeWire, it, the subject, takes one or two days. Right, two constituents. Here we've got a Swedish example, yesterday, igår, or something like that. Forgive my Swedish pronunciation if you're a pro. I was sick, right? Not today was I sick, which is what you'd expect under a verb second grammar. So Old English is not alone. It's found some weird friends in its weirdness, but it's found them in a rather unexpected place in these urban vernacular varieties. Now, there's quite a lot to be said about this. I'll just sketch the argument here. First of all, one thing that you could maybe say, if you didn't know very much about the sociolinguistic situation of these varieties, is to say that these people who are speaking Kiezdeutsch, they're not speaking another dialect, they're just bad at German. They're just speaking a sort of a crappy variety of German that has arisen because they didn't learn it properly. That can't possibly be right. And we've got good evidence that that's not the case. For a start, pretty much all of the people who've been investigated who can do this, who can speak this variety, can fluently code switch into standard German as well. So if they're in a job interview, they're probably not going to talk like this, but when they're with their friends in an informal situation, they will happily use this Kiezdeutsch grammar. And in fact, many of these speakers are not second language learners of German at all. They're first language learners of German, and they've acquired this extra variety, but they don't speak any other languages other than German and Kiezdeutsch. The other thing that suggests, and I can't dwell on this, the other thing that suggests that there's something special going on here is that the alternation between verb second and verb third, it shows sensitivity to information structure. Broadly speaking, are we dealing with a new element in the discourse or something that's been previously mentioned in the discourse? And that affects whether you get verb second or verb third. That's not what we would necessarily expect if this was simply some kind of inadequate German that has been acquired badly. Furthermore, other aspects of German syntax are quite often intact. So for instance, the Satzklammer, the verbal bracket where you have your non-finite verb right at the end of the sentence, that is perfectly intact in these varieties. They don't make any mistakes there whatsoever. So this isn't just some inadequate variety, this is a new variety with its own norms and with its own properties. And the same arguments can be replicated for every single one of these Germanic urban vernaculars that I've mentioned. So, but nevertheless, we can ask ourselves something else. We can ask, is there a language contact effect here? And that seems plausible. So these urban vernaculars that we've been talking about have emerged independently in multilingual areas, right? There is a verb third variety in Stockholm, there is one in Copenhagen, there is one in Berlin and other German cities too, and there is one in Oslo. So why? Why have they developed independently along the same lines? Well, this is where I think some kind of role for a second language acquisition story does come in. And the story very briefly goes like this. First of all, verb second is hard. Germanic is full of verb second, but there have been lots of studies on the acquisition of verb second which show that people trying to learn it who have other backgrounds have a really hard time. Right? They don't easily pick up this special rule which says you have to always have one and only one constituent in front of the finite verb. And this is even true for speakers of verb second language. So there's been evidence, for instance, there have been studies that show that learners of Swedish who are trying to learn German, Tanya's looking very skeptical here, but I prefer to believe that this is a real finding. The learners of Swedish who are learning German, both verb second languages, still make errors in the verb second property when they're learning it as a second language. So what's the scenario? Well, the scenario works as follows. First of all, you get first generation immigrants, moving to a big urban area. These are all very multilingual areas, even if the individual speakers are not necessarily multilingual. So here you have the people who really are learning German or Swedish or Danish as a second language and who really are making mistakes, because that's what people do. But then when the really interesting thing happens is when you get children into the picture, because children are really good at learning languages. And they're unlikely to make the same kind of mistakes as their aged parents. So when the children start getting input, they think, hey, what's going on? I'm getting verb third structures in my input. They could just throw them away, of course, but for whatever reason, and I'm hazy on this point, they don't do that. They actually incorporate these verb third structures, but they have a different underlying structure. They have a different function. They're used with a particular information structural role. And the other part of the picture, which should really not be underestimated, is that verb third is then recruited as a marker of linguistic group identity. So this is certainly true for all of the Germanic varieties in question. People know about this variable, right? They know that verb second is a special feature that marks them out or can mark them out as non-standard speakers, or the lack of verb second, rather. Okay, so that's a detour into the present day. What happens when we look at Old English? Well, this is the part where it gets really speculative, but one thing that has become uncovered by archaeologists and by historians over the last 20, 30 years in study of the prehistory of Britain is that when the Anglo-Saxons arrived on the British Isles, they didn't just kill everyone or drive them away. I mean, that should have been obvious from the start, right? Why would they just kill, like brutally slaughter everyone in the islands, right? Surely it would have been much better to turn some of them into slaves, or, you know, or to steal away the women and make them into their wives, or something equally nasty, but much more practical. And that indeed is what has been argued to have happened. So there are two models. Either there was a sort of elite emulation where you have a small sort of coterie of lords, Anglo-Saxon lords, and most of the people around them were in fact native Celtic speakers. Oh. Either that, or you have some sort of apartheid situation in which you have essentially separate communities and separate social structures for Anglo-Saxons, people identifying as Anglo-Saxons and people identifying as Celts. But that they largely kept to themselves, with the exception of some slavery-related practices, which now again is very, very well documented for the early stages of the British Isles. The British took clearly a very long time to get over this idea of taking slaves. It's not a great part of our history. And here what you've got is the possibility you've got language shift, because what we know without a doubt is that by the time of the 10th century, Celtic had died out in England. There were no speakers of it left. It still survives in places like Wales and Scotland, but not in England. So there must have been a very, very large-scale language shift situation in this very earliest stage of the language. That, I would argue, is likely to cause similar kinds of effects to the ones that we just saw in the modern urban vernaculars, albeit in a very different socio-historical context. I'll just end this case study with this sort of provocative note. Maybe West Saxon Old English is the Kiezdeutsch of its day. Right. It was just ahead of its time. Moving on to then the second case study, and if you're feeling overwhelmed with slides with lots of text, don't worry, there are some maps coming up, nice colourful maps. What are we looking at here? We're looking at a major change that happens in the history of negation in English. And this is a change that's sometimes called Jespersen's cycle, after the Danish linguist Otto Jespersen. This is part of a wider project of mine and some colleagues looking at change in negation in language context situations more generally. What happens to negation? Now, this is a change that has been investigated before a lot, but not from this perspective. And no one has done what we've done. So this is a fairly small, but hopefully quite detailed and quite convincing study, at least in, as far as the empirical material is concerned. We used a resource called the Linguistic Atlas of Early Middle English, which contains a lot of text which importantly are dated and localized. You know where these texts are from and when they were written. That's not to be, that can't be taken for granted with historical documents. A very large amount of the time we don't really know. And for some texts, like the Old English Beowulf, people's estimates swing wildly 400 years either side. But for these texts, we know roughly when and where they were written, and so we can use this kind of resource to investigate the geographic distribution of the early varieties, and use a few little bits and pieces of open source software. As Regina mentioned, I'm very into open everything, open access publications, open source software. Open bar is always good. Generally, openness is something I'm massively in favour of. We use these two pieces of software, R for the statistics, QGIS for the maps, and our question that we wanted to answer is, again, is there language context involved? So just to illustrate the different variants that we're looking at here, and the colour coding is important, the blue variant just has a N before the finite verb. So this, we've got example, he nüsste, waar he wär. He didn't know, they didn't know where they were. And this N is tacked onto the front of the verb, and this is your only negation marker in stage one. Stage two, you've got a ne before the verb, just like in stage one, but you've also got this nocht post-verbally. Now, this is the point where if you know any French, you go, hey, this looks like written French, right? This looks like ne pas in French, and indeed, it seems to have roughly the same structure. So this stage two is the French-like option, but what we're really interested in is stage three, where the ne has dropped off, and all we're left with is the Nocht, which has various different spellings, but it's reliably the same element. So let's look at some of these beautiful maps. Well, here we've got little pie charts. The blue is stage one, the red is stage two, and the green is stage three. And what you'll see from this chart is, on the one hand, we don't have very many texts, right? Mostly one big one. The size of the pie chart tells you how many examples we're dealing with. So we don't have very many texts. We also don't have much stage three. There are a few examples in these smaller texts that are slightly further north. But this on its own tells us very little. Zoom forward 50 years. Now you've got more texts. But again, they're not ideally distributed for the purposes that we're interested in. But again, what you see is that there are a few tokens of stage three, the nocht on its own as a negator. There are a few tokens knocking around, mostly sort of further north, a few in the Midlands. This is just a zoom in on some of the texts that we see in the Midlands. But this is a very rare structure at this point. Another 50 years go past, and a little bit has changed, but still not a huge amount. You've got a little bit of stage three up here, you've got stage three, some stage three down here, and in this Midlands area, you're starting to get texts that show it. But you've got a huge amount of variability, and a very vague tendency that these things show up slightly north of other texts that don't have it. Right, so stage three is something that we find in the north, or at least northwards. But let's look, and we can scroll back very quickly through these three maps. We've got nothing north of here, right? Here's roughly where I grew up. There's nothing from this area, this whole huge area of England, up to the top here, which is very often ignored in more ways than one, both linguistically and politically. Chip on my shoulder here, that James at the back will probably appreciate. Here, finally, we get to post 1300, and look, we've got northern texts, and the northern texts are green, or maybe you'd prefer to call it yellow, but to me this is green. So we've got loads of green up here. We've even got some text where this is very clearly the majority variant, but we only see these cropping up after 1350. So the historical development is a little bit unsatisfying here because the area, in a way, that we're really interested in is the area which doesn't have any data from before this time. If you plot the whole lot, if you collapse these 200 years together, oh no, that's not it. This is if you just do the graph. So the green is the new variant, the red is stage two, the blue is stage one. What we see is that there isn't a whole lot of change, in fact, until this last period when the green suddenly shoots up at expense of both of the other variants. Right, so this is the new variant coming in. But again, it's important to have the caveat that the change is probably not as fast as this. If we had text from the whole area, we would probably see something quite different happening in terms of the distribution of the three variants. So here's a different map. This collapses everything together. And what it shows is that these darker texts, the darker the text, the more stage three there is in that text, as opposed to the other two variants. What we can think here, and anyone who looks at the history of English, especially around this time, sees something that happens more in the north and more in the east, is going to come to the same kind of hypothesis that we did, which is, hey, what if it was the Vikings? And Vikings is a bad term, I'll get to that, but we know very well that there was a huge influx of Scandinavian speakers into this northeastern area of the country. And again, some people have tried to play this down. Peter Sawyer, in his book, has claimed that this is historically that the numbers were negligible, that we were really dealing with Viking raiders who came but didn't really settle. They just plundered and did their other business and then went away again. The majority scholarship has come to the conclusion that there actually really was quite a lot of settlement. So Scandinavians did come and they did settle in this area. This area in particular was settled by Danish speakers. Up here, we've also got an area where Norwegians come in, because what they do is they come all the way around the top, around the north of Scotland, and they get into this area here. But we don't have any text at all from that area, so that's kind of irrelevant, sadly, or at least nothing that's right. So what does this Scandinavian hypothesis have speaking for it? Here is our Viking, and I should make one important correction to this picture, which is that we now know through archaeological research that horned helmets were not actually a thing, which should really be obvious, because why would you wear a helmet that allowed people to grab onto your head in the midst of battle? Right? It's a really stupid idea. But everything else in this picture is 100% historically accurate. So what we can tell, what we know, again, we've got a circumstantial case for Scandinavian influence here. Scandinavian definitely had the structure that Middle English develops, the stage three structure. It didn't have the same word, but syntactic influence doesn't have to involve the same word in order to be real. In fact, probably not going to. There's certainly nothing rare about negators. You hear them all the time. So it's quite plausible that these people would have picked up on the negator in the English that they were speaking, but not on everything else. Like I said, we know that there must have been quite a lot of these Scandinavians, not just men with horned helmets or without horned helmets and axes, but also women, children, settlements. There were substantial Scandinavian settlements in the northeast. And then at that point, the only question is, if this change was in fact triggered by Scandinavian influence, why did it happen as late as it did? And there's actually two answers to that question. The first texts that we have from the relevant period are actually quite late already. So it could well have been that in the relevant area, there was a very large use of this thing already by the time of the attested texts. In fact, given that these texts crop out of nowhere, with quite a large proportion of stage three and nothing before them, that seems quite likely, given what we know about the gradual spread of language change. The other part of the issue was North Germanic and Early English were in a very special situation as regards multilingualism. At least the most convincing case in this debate that I have read is Matthew Townend's book, where he argues that actually these early North Germanic speakers and the early Old English speakers could actually understand each other. It wouldn't be easy, but they could just about do it, right? They could conduct basic communication. And what happens was we have a situation of what's sometimes called receptive multilingualism. I'm a Viking, I speak Viking to you. You're an Old English person, you speak Old English to me. We half of the time understand what each other is saying, but hopefully that's enough, and hopefully the Viking won't get angry and kill everyone else with an axe. So this is the situation, and this is not the kind of situation that's enormously likely to lead to syntactic transfer under normal assumptions, because they're simply never using the other language. When do they start to use the other language? That comes later, because in the 11th and 12th centuries, The Anglo-Norse that was spoken in the British Isles, and we have good evidence for this, the Anglo-Norse that was spoken in the British Isles died out. And at this point, it died out in all of England by the end, probably by the end of the 12th century, though it's a little bit hard to tell. It stuck around in places like Orkney in the far north of Scotland for a lot longer, but that doesn't concern us now. The important thing is that, particularly in the East Midlands, this language would have been dying out during this era, and language death comes with language shift, and language shift comes with syntactic influence. So that is the argument in a nutshell in this particular case. So just to wrap up then, because my voice is running low on juice, what next? So first of all, it's important to state that explaining some aspect of the weirdness of English does not necessarily make it not weird anymore. In some cases, as in the case of verb second, we might decide that the property that we thought was completely exceptional is not in fact as exceptional as we thought. In other cases, well, it might be weird, but the weirdness is explicable in terms of the historical circumstances and context that the English language has undergone, and that other Germanic languages have not undergone in the same way to the same extent. So I've made the case for two context situations here. First of all, Old English losing strict verb second through contact with speakers of Celtic. And secondly, negation changing to its modern form through the influence of Scandinavians, of North Germanic speakers. And I think, just as some I mentioned with some of the other theories, you may not like these ideas. And it may be that future researchers are going to come along and come up with good reasons why these scenarios can't possibly be true. But I still think what's happened here is that to bring the data together in this way, to collect the data in this way, has stimulated research in certain areas. I'd like to hope, as a kind of very modest ambition, and provided and also helped to improve our empirical base and the resources that we have available to us to talk about these changes. One thing that's very clearly true is that we know an awful lot more about the detailed time course of linguistic change now than we could have ever hoped to 20, 30, 40 years ago through the advent of this kind of historical corpus data and the development of new historical corpus resources, allowing us to track these changes very, very precisely. So here's one generalization that one can make. Language change is very often S-shaped. When you look at the course of a change, we see that it starts off very slow, moves, progresses, becomes gradually faster towards the midpoint of the change, and then gets slower again towards the completion. So you have this characteristic S-shaped curve that we see in change after change and language after language after language. Here are just a couple of examples of bits of S-shapes from my own work. This is null subjects in Icelandic, this is null subjects in English, if you're interested. I'm definitely interested. When you've got data like this, though, you can go beyond simply plotting things on graphs, right? You can actually try and build models, predictive models of what's going on in these data sets. And here I'm using prediction in a fairly standard scientific sense. This is a model that my former PhD student, now postdoc, Henry Kauhanen, has developed in collaboration with me. It's about the relation between different contexts of the same change. I'm not going to explain it in full now because that would take way longer than we have. But the important thing about it is that it looks really nice. There are lots of different colours and it's kind of a rainbow pattern, right? So it's very impressive, and I can blind you with numbers. I'm interested in another question, and the question is, will it ever be possible to really predict change? That is, as historical linguists, can we look at the future and see what it will hold? Well, traditionally, the outlook on this has been very, very negative. So traditionally, people have said, well, we probably can't reach that level of specificity in historical linguistics. Changes are necessarily unpredictable. There are social factors that get involved in ways that we can't predict or control for, and therefore we really shouldn't bother trying. And there, I think, is where I would like to differ from those people, because I think even if we end up failing horribly, it would still be interesting to try and see where it gets us. So I'm really holding out hope that in the near future, we will be able to see on our TV screens something like the following. So you're watching the English language forecast of 2048, April, the month of April. So this is going to be a generally pretty pleasant month, sentences not too long. There are going to be patches of high vowels, maybe around the North Pennines. One thing to watch out for is deletion of the definite article. We're going to see this cropping up, maybe sweeping in from the east. On the other side, we're going to see coming in from the, wait, that was the west, this is the east. I could never make it as a weather forecaster. Coming in from the east, the actual east, we have a swathe of words from Danish, which will be infiltrating your language very, very soon. And during the latter part of the month, you may wish to stay indoors because we will be seeing a freak emoji explosion where left, right, and center emojis are going to emerge, take over our language, and ruin it for all of time. So that was the English language weather forecast, and yeah, thank you very much.